Hello, hello, hello. Welcome back, everyone, to the second part of this important series in the SE community, an important segment in the SE community conversation series. It's awesome to have you here with us today. I'm so excited for what you're going to find we have in store for you in the next hour and a half that we're going to spend together. I'm just going to breathe with y'all for a moment. It's kind of an intense time on the planet, and this topic brings with it its own intense pressure. You know, it could be said to do that. You know, we come to the conversation of the threat of war and armed conflict with our own personal histories of living with threat, maybe experiencing war or surviving war. Or maybe we just come to this conversation with a background in somatic work and wellness. And so I just want to bring us all present to the moment that we're in right now, excuse me, where we're about to spend some time really exploring what resources of safety, wellness, and connection can do in the face of the threat of war. So my name is Ami Lee. I'm the Director of Public Health with SE International. I'm sure some of you are very familiar with the organization, and that's why you're here. Some of you have been joining us for the ongoing SE community conversations that happens on the second Friday every month at this time on relevant topics in public health, where we bring our resources of somatic, physiological wellness, of neurobiological balancing, of all sorts of cool ways to connect the body, the brain, the mind, and the spirit, the person, and the profession, so that we can experience some profound wellness. So today's topic and people are a little different than usual. We often feature the practitioners in our community, but today I'm excited to feature the faculty. So I'm just going to give you a little rundown on how we'll do today's session, and then we'll go ahead and get right to it and see what's there. So I see some of you have been to these conversation series before, and so you know a little bit about what we're going to do. First, I want to tell you that we will be using the raise hand feature in our time together, when we may bring some of you on screen for an exercise, or we may bring you on to ask a question. So I first want to make sure that you completely know where that raise hand feature is. So if you are looking at your screen, at the bottom of your screen, there should be a button called reactions. And in there, you'll see an option to raise hand. If you currently are a student of somatic experiencing or a somatic experiencing practitioner. If that's not you and you're like, I don't know what that is, don't worry. But if that's you, if you are a student or a practitioner, would you please go to the reactions and raise your hand so we know how many of you come from that kind of a background? All right, folks are starting to raise their hand. So far, there's just a small fraction, not even 10% of the folks are that. Please do raise your hand if that's you, just so we can know today. Because I also don't want to get into like heavy jargon if that's not you. So, all right, it looks like about 20-25% of the people right now are currently SE students or SE practitioners. We're going to go ahead and lower all your hands. So go ahead and stop raising them for a moment. And if you are not a somatic experiencing practitioner or student, please raise your hand. That's just gonna help me know what kind of participation we already have with us today. Cool, all right, I am seeing a lot. Okay, that's great. So you guys are participating and you're just really coming to get some resources. That's what I'm making up about you right now. And you, okay, yeah, we got about half of you. So then there's just about 20% are not responding. Okay, go ahead and I'm going to lower all your hands. There we go. So that's good. That helps us know how we can make this series really relevant to give you resources that make a difference for you. you may have signed on today because you have experienced the threat of war, or you are currently in that scenario. And if that is you, I really reach out to you from the space of connectedness that we're going to share, that you really can let in, that you're here with a whole bunch of people who care about your experience, who may share in it, and who are having their own experience to get related about. There's a certain resource just in the connectivity of life. But hey, I can say that all day long, and I'm still just a talking hat on a screen until we get a little bit more acquainted. So the next thing we're going to do, so that we understand how today's format works, is we're going to get acquainted with the Q&A feature of the screen. The question and answer is what that stands for in English. I know all of you may not speak English as a first language, so I see a lot of interesting names in our list. And so I welcome you from wherever you are in the globe. We're going to have a whole world conversation today. And so let's get to know where you are in the world to really get you connected with everyone else here. So please go to the bottom of your screen where you will see a Q&A option. If you're on a phone, even sometimes you can slide across. It's in there somewhere. Search around on your little Zoom screen to find where it says Q&A. And if you could please go in there, and you'll see that there's a post from Rabia, who is a project coordinator with SEI. She's going to be in there giving you any information you might need that you might hear spoken about today. If a book is mentioned or something, you're going to find it in there. She's going to be sharing links and things to really support you. But you're going to go in there right now, if you can, and type in, where are you chiming in from? Let's really start to get a sense of who's here. And some of you may not be able to type in. You may not have a whole lot of access to typing. But if you could go into the Q&A and type, all right, Summer, kicking us off from Ontario, Canada, welcome. Michelle from Oregon, tomorrow in the Netherlands. Wow, great to have you. Hello, Karen in Prague. All right. Karina in the UK. My goodness. And Anne in Santa Cruz. I can picture your coasts. Anna in Ontario. Okay, folks are chiming in. We're getting acquainted. We can already see that several continents are represented here. And so that will be the context of our conversation. In that Q&A, as we're together, please at any point, whether it's now, you may have already come online with a question, what you're dealing with or someone you're supporting, please put any questions that we can get answered for you or just to get in dialogue about in that Q&A while we're together. And please, if you don't have questions, peek in there when someone does, and there's a little option to, you know, if you scroll over something, you'll be able to put a thumbs up on it, I'm trying to look to make sure that that's possible. You want to make sure that you can put a thumbs up on there so that we can know that they're there, that you can upvote. It's a very Facebook-y kind of term, but you can upvote the questions to let us know that you all may have the same one, or you may share in it. Also, one more thing, kind of just logistics. You might also, when you put your question, if you think about it, put that you'd be willing to come on screen and ask it live. I know that Russell and Effie would probably really love to engage with you and explore some topics with you. So if you're willing to come over here on screen with us, it'll be a little technical glitchy for a moment. You'll get some prompts to come over, but put it in your question. Like, hey, I have the question. It's blah, blah, blah. And I'd be willing to come answer it live. That would be great. So that's kind of how today goes. And that's our kind of long and short of it. In just a moment, without another moment's further ado, I will bring our speakers onto the screen with us so that we can get connected in one conversation. Today's session isn't just a presentation on a topic. It really is a conversation, because really everyone on the planet right now is dealing with the current threat of war that we know is happening in one region, although there's plenty of other regions that are experiencing ongoing threats. And those are the kind of things we'll be talking about. So Effie, Russell, would you join us? And we can go ahead and get started in this conversation and get resourced in this conversation. Hi, welcome. I love seeing your faces. Oh man, yeah. We already connected a little bit, and even just having you on screen and off screen for a little bit, I'm going to notice for myself, almost just for this whole session, just seeing you again, like I felt the warmness in my body and the happiness to be with you. That's going to be the last thing I say before I shut this trapezoid. I want to kick us off and welcome you by saying, could you help everyone who's present get to know you by telling us a little bit about who you are, where you're at? I could read your bio, but man, we're going to just get to know you. That's really going to be where this is at today. Could you please answer the question for us, where you currently are or wherever you've been, kind of in relation to location, since this is a world thing. What's going on around you with the current like threat of war or armed conflict? And I'm even just going to name like, hey, here in the United States, we're having so many mass shootings very recently that it extends the threat of the war to the very personal and the very broad. So however you want to share, whenever you want to get us started, welcome. And who wants to take it away first?
Okay, I will go first, Russell, if you don't mind. Next time I'll let you go first.
Go for it. Thanks.
Yes. Thank you, Tammy. Thank you, everyone who is out there. We're really happy to know that you're out there listening and we're conversing with you, even though we don't see you, but we are aware that you're there. Yes, as Ami has mentioned, my name is Efu, you know, SC, part of SC community. And right now, I mean, I'm from Tanzania originally. I live in Brazil for a number of years. That's my home for now. But right now at this moment, I'm in South Korea giving training and workshops on trauma healing. And, you know, talking about threat of war, it's amazing. I've been here for 5 weeks now. And we're talking about war. It's constantly reminding us here, people bring it up of their grandparents who were in the war between Japan and Korea, South Korea, and of course the split between South Korea and North Korea. And that is such a threat because it's still in their DNA, those students talking to us right now. And amazingly, how that it's still a threat that it's coming from within. Yeah. And then, of course, you talk about those who are listening to the news constantly having this threat coming from outside. So it's not easy, but we are able to create a safe place, the island of safety around us, so that we can have some laughter. We can have some moments that we can take a deep sigh, a deep breath from that situation. And so that's what is going on here, even though the war is not going on here right now, but we are reminded of the past, this connection. So I would like to stop there and give chance to Russell, though, to join us, like I call him in Brazil, we're together so that. So Jonas, it's for you right now, and then we'll get back.
Thank you, Efu, for starting us out. And thank you, Ami, for being on the screen and giving us that great introduction. So I am in Brazil. I was born and raised in the United States, but I've been living in Brazil for many decades. I am in the south of Brazil on a large island of Santa Catarina right now. And this is a little challenging. Efu must be used to it too. We're used to teaching trainings online. And when you teach the trainings, you get to see all the people in their little boxes. I have a big screen here and I get to see all of you. But right now I'm just looking at Efu actually. I'm going to take myself off the screen. So I'm just looking at Efu in her beautiful, lovely clothing. She's always got such lovely, colorful clothing. So I'm mostly looking at her and her nice smile, and knowing that you're all out there listening too is really appreciative. So here in Brazil, you know, it's a stressful time as it is in many places in the world. The economy is very difficult. There's a lot of stress, a lot of fear, a lot of worry about people having enough, a lot of violence in the cities, especially here, which many of them, you know, are like small war zones in themselves. And Interestingly enough, in the connections, I was just teaching in South Korea, just taught a training for South Korea online just a few weeks ago, and we were talking about the war there and how actually there is an armistice there. The war has not ended. It's a truce. It's a long-term truce. So the war is still present there. And a week before, I was teaching a training in Sapporo, Japan, there, where also, you know, they have that aforementioned the connection between Japan and Korea, but also between Japan and the United States. And it's going way back, but my father was a soldier, a 19-year-old young man became a soldier in World War II. And he was in the South Pacific in Japan during that time. And so there's a direct connection for me in working with trauma and working with, I also teach Aikido, a Japanese martial art, and working with trying to find some kind of renegotiation, we call it, some kind of peace there within the us as our society now. And so, you know, I can say more about my experience as a child growing up with my father, who was extremely traumatized by the war, so much so. And I had the good fortune of studying Aikido with a Japanese master and going and getting to know his father, who had been a Japanese soldier during World War II. So there was a link, a connection there of working through some of all of that horrific pain and suffering that comes up in all wars. In this most latest war in the Ukraine, I think is bringing it to the forefront, you know, that it's global now. When this happens in one place, it affects everyone everywhere. And as Efu mentioned, in all the different generations too, you know, war is a transgenerational effect, a transgenerational trauma, as well as being social, very much social. And here we are trying to connect socially through the screen here. I'm looking at Efu, so mostly I'm connecting with her, and I'm imagining all of you. I read some of the what you wrote from different places there, and I'm imagining where you are all over the world. So I'm sitting here in Brazil. Efu lives in North Brazil, where it's quite warm. I'm here where it's cool. But the war and the threat of war and the cost of gasoline, for example, has gone up, skyrocketed here in Brazil. It's very difficult for transport. It's very difficult for everyone, the economic effects. And then also the heaviness of that energy, which I really feel is global. It's in the global field there. So I'm going to bat the ball back to Efu. Efu, hold out your hands.
Okay.
I'm gonna send right. The ball back to you. Here it comes.
Yes, okay. I caught it. Yeah, and you know, Russell, I agree with you. And also one other thing I wanted to mention about Brazil, in the northeast of Brazil, all the rains that have been affecting so many people and mudslides. I'm constantly also receiving messages from there because I live in the Northeast, as Russell mentioned. So apart from the walls, we have all these other threats that are also in different pockets around the world. And with somatic experiencing, we are trying to hold all of that. And even some sessions online with these people who were affected by mudslide in the Northeast, you know, trying to help people find the pockets of safety, as I said. And thank God for our evolution. At this moment, we can actually even connect through this way we are here, you know, with our Zoom, with many other ways that with social media, this helps us actually to feel a little safe as we connect with others who are going through the same kind of situations. One of the things I just wanted to say is that, you know, listening to the news constantly, it's really, you know, it's good to update ourselves of what's going on. But probably it's one advice I would just say to all of us and to people you are attending, that if they could cut up the amount of time that you spend on the screen listening to all of the details, because that is, as traumatized as it can be constantly when you're looking at it. So sometimes just advise people to kind of get the necessary information, but let go of having all the details, especially the action moments, because that is also as traumatizing as it is happening in the war zone or in the activities of trauma vortex. And if you have to watch the news in order to get the information and update yourself, we advise that you kind of watch that with, like, in a somatic experiencing world, we call it being grounded, feeling like your feet, you have a little bit of stabilization, like noticing the feet on the ground or rocking chair where you're rocking yourself as you're watching, so that you kind of feel something that helps you to connect to your own body as you are there. You know, most of the time, I think we are traumatized, especially when the moment we feel that this is too much, and then we dissociate or we freeze. And then that is when the major problem comes, because we start having panic attacks later on or at night. But if we are constantly present, even when we're trying to update ourselves, we will know when it is too much for us, and so that we can maybe stop and connect with something that it is helping us to feel safe, helping us to feel connected with ourselves and with the environment where we are at that moment, which help us to feel safe. Yeah, so these are the things that we're just kind of helping people to continue surviving and be able to connect with those who are right in the zone where they are really receiving, we will call it in the middle of the trauma vortex. So, okay, I will, Russ, I'm going to throw the ball back to you again. Here it is. Catch it, please.
Yeah, there it is.
Thank you.
Thank you, Afu. Mm-hmm. I got the ball right back. Yeah. Right yeah, back yeah. at you. So this is fun. Afu was talking about safety and what the term we sometimes call a resource, which is anything that helps us feel better, feel more safe, more connected, more alive. And that's, you know, one of the huge challenges of facing war and war zones is that so much death and destruction and oftentimes torture there, horrific ways of dying, a great deal of suffering. So when we see that, when we think about that, it naturally connects us to our own relationship with our own mortality and our own vision of our own death. And so our beliefs around that are really important, what our own beliefs are about life and death, and those are really challenged in these moments there. And then also, you know, the basic question of human goodness too, I think comes up for me when I talk about this and when I look at these, as Afu says, the news trying to take it in minimal doses, because it is very stressful, very frightening, very painful just to watch other people suffering. You know, we call that horror sometimes. Witnessing other people suffering can also be traumatic for us. So there is one question, a big question that comes up in this category, this area of talking about wars. How is it that some of us anyway, as human beings, are capable of going to another place, going somewheres and killing people, right? Because all of us have the instinct to defend ourselves if someone's directly attacking us. That's our nature. That's the fight flight response that we have to protect ourselves and protect those close to us, you know? So in that sense, we're all capable of killing. Every human being, as a human mammal, is capable of killing to protect ourselves and our loved ones. You know, and Ron Kurtz, the founder of the Hakomi method, was quoted as saying that on some level, we all need to know that killer inside of us, that part of us that is capable of killing. And I think we can all understand that from a point of self-defense of us, ourselves, and our people close to us, our loved ones. But then how is it we as human beings can sort of diabolically create a system or create ways to go to other places to try to, for whatever reasons, for political reasons, for economical reasons, for religious, social reasons, for all sorts of reasons, to go there and harm other people when it's not out of self-defense, you know? It brings up that question of basic human goodness, you know? And how do we restore our faith and belief in our natural goodness as human beings and human animals and human mammals there? There's some brilliant work done by Sam Keen called Faces of the Enemy, a book and a PBS documentary, where he went back and studied for wars and conflicts all over the globe and how the two sides were able to harm each other, or more than two sides, and how there's this universal act of vilifying the enemy, making them seem less than human, making them seem like parasites, like something horrible, something terrible, something evil there. And how that has, as one way that has been used throughout history to be able to harm other people, to be able to make war on other people when it's not out of self-defense. And, you know, I've had the good fortune to sit up late nights talking to Sam about that and discussing him studying that. And he went and interviewed people all over the world and interviewed ex-soldiers and interviewed people in prison who had done terrible things to try to get a sense of, you know, how is that? How are we capable of doing that? And how can we deal with that as human beings? How can we heal from that? How can we help others heal from that? And how can we restore, again, our own desire to be part of this human race? And it seems to me like we're in a really, really challenging moment right now in that, where there's so many things. There's the war in the Ukraine. And we have to think that, you know, the Ukraine task force from SE, when Ami's group, helping those people and helping the people who are suffering there and helping the refugees. And there's so many people from so many different groups helping, and how that war has vibrations across the world and connects to all other wars. This is something we learn about trauma. All traumas connect in one way or another. So that war somehow connects to all other wars, right? And Efu can speak to the transgenerational part of that with her work there. And so that, you know, I'd like to bring up that question for our discussion today too, you know. How is it that we are able as human beings to do that? And how is it that each one of us relates to that and copes with that and finds our own connection to our own desire to protect and to help other people rather than to harm other people? Shall I send you the ball back, Efu?
Yes, I will catch it. I'll catch it. Thank you. Yes, there you go. Yes, Russ. Thank you. Yeah, Russ, you know, you brought up some very important key points here about this human race and the connection between the human being. And also you touched one point, I think, which is like, I will call it spiritual connection. Yeah. And this part of spiritual connection, it's so important. I think with everything that is going on right now, it's not just the war situation. I don't want to deviate it from the war situation, but there's all kinds of small threats that are going on. Like Amy reminded us in the United States, there are all kinds of shooting going on around. And then we can mention so many situations around the world. So it's like we are in crisis. Isn't this a moment to stop and actually notice what is going on instead of looking at the other person here, there, like kind of judging, why is that group doing this? Or why is that person doing that? Isn't that terrible to be able to do that? And I remember also, Russ, you started with that inside of us, we do have that capacity actually to harm another person, but not wanting to, when we want to defend ourselves. So I think this way of developing spiritual or practices, which is not, I'm not talking about going to the temples and going to the churches and going to do all these practices like prayers, which part, it could be part of that. But it's the connection with our own being, connection with our own inner self. And somatic experiencing, really, is just paying attention to our breath, paying attention to our body, and just wait a little bit to see what is happening. That really helps. And when I talk about spiritual practices, I'm talking about simple things like when I feel rage inside of me because I can think of those who are killing in the war right now, or those who are killing other people who have massacred people, and I feel so much rage. If I could actually just stop for a while and pay attention to my body, I can actually connect to something that will identify myself with that person, or will identify myself with the victim. But that's, we don't want to go too deep on that. We just want to be present with the breath, which is life. Yeah, we talk about life. We talk about war actually bringing up killing. You know, we are put in touch with our own mortality, with our own death. But when we pay attention to our body for 1 second and realize that we are breathing, we are alive. That's really, really, for me, I always say that is something to be thankful for. I have a person that lives with me, a friend, a sister. You know, I'm a religious, and she's a sister. During the pandemic situation, which still goes on, of course, as part of our reality, she will wake up in the morning and she say, I said, how did you sleep? She said, thank God I'm alive. So many that are dying, thank God I'm alive. And that for me was a spiritual moment whenever I heard that phrase, thank God I'm alive. So I just felt like inviting everybody to wherever you are, every minute, you actually get in touch with your breath and notice that, oh, wow, I'm alive. You can say that. Thank God I'm alive. I have survived many moments. And I'm alive. And if I'm alive, maybe my breath out can go to those who are suffering, who are in the middle of trauma. And so this is a way I can actually contribute, and as I can develop the spiritual moments that are very quick, you know, like we can work with that. And that will help us to deal with our anger, will help us to deal with our fear, will help us to deal with our guilt. If we are reminded of what we have done also, that it's connecting to the world, it's connecting to what's going around us, really small things like that help us to take care of ourselves while we connect with one another. Yeah, and I see Ami there. I'm sure Ami has something that she wants to bring for us, right, Russell? Maybe I should kind of stop here and give her a chance.
You're muted, Ami.
Of course, I don't know when he says don't mute. There I am. I'm just over here saying I'm alive. I'm feeling it. I'm alive. Thank you for that. And it's really something to be with you, listening to the things that you're starting to share. It's really provocative, right? Like, I feel you're just really plugging us into our absolute mortality each day as a resource, that each day, like your sister, we wake up and proclaim that we're here for it. And Russell, I really hear you calling us into this space of, you know, looking at the range within us, you know, this of the terrible and the wonderful, and that we could cause harm out of an urge to protect. These are very provocative topics. And I just want to name like how much there is inside this big topic of dealing with the threat of war for each of us. As you're naming that, there was someone who started to write into the Q&A a question. And it was interesting, Russell, it was right before you started to talk about us plugging into our own experience of ourself as killer, ourself as protector. And I noticed for myself, I'm just going to name it. I was like, it brought up a lot of activation, and it may have online too. So guys, to everybody who's with us, like, if you notice that, if you notice these topics are pretty provocative and something's going on with you over there, like, go ahead and put something in the chat and let us know and come talk about it. Like, really, this is a space for us to be together. Russell and Efu, as you can see, you guys, well, they're teachers. They're just teachers. They like, it's who they are in life. They'll be teaching, but we're also just listening in conversation and in conversation with you. So I'd love to bring Summer online to ask her question. She's dealing with people who have been the mercenaries, with the veterans, with the military, who are now trying to cope and struggle with some of their life. And so Summer, if we could get some tech support, she's coming online. Are y'all okay with us having Summer bring her video up and ask you the question directly?
Sure.
Hello.
Hi, Summer.
Hi, Summer.
Hi. So I'm curious to know, you know, what are some supportive ways that we can be present with veterans who are being triggered by current war? So, I mean, I have, you know, people that I'm working with who were triggered by, you know, the fall of Afghanistan, and, you know, they had served there, and then now they're being triggered by, you know, war in Europe, and they'd served there as well. And so I'm finding that some of my clients are really experiencing like really strong somatic reactions to just like the frustration that their sacrifice, both mental and physical, hasn't made a difference in their minds.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Russell.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, yeah, I mean, that's a really present thing that's got to be happening all in many, many places on many levels. I think it's really important, Summer, you know, to recognize that triggering is happening and not trying to hold it down or separate from it, you know, to recognize that it is happening and that is, it's a natural reaction, right? For any of us who've been in that kind of situation, and even for those of us who haven't been in that, but especially those of us who are veterans who've been in those situations, that when we hear about it, when we see that, we see things happening that have affected the work we've done. And it seems like maybe that work is we gave all we had and many people died, and it seems like it didn't make a difference. I think it's really important to recognize that, you know, start by recognizing that. And something that, you know, we do, Efo and I are both somatic experiencing teachers, something that we do, and I think you can tell from my voice, we try to slow things down as we recognize it, right? And sounds like you've got a handle on that too, right? So as we're recognizing the trigger and that activation, as we call it, it's a technical term, maybe some people aren't used to that, but as that activation comes up, really slowing things down, you know, acknowledging that it's there and slowing things down, because when that activation, when that trigger happens, it's looking for a way to deactivate and complete, right? It's a wave, it's a normal response for all of us. The difficulty is when the wave just keeps going up, right? And so it gets triggered and gets triggered again, triggered again, triggered again. And so not acknowledging it can actually trigger it more in my experience. So really acknowledging it and trying to slow things down. And there's some basic resources that seem to be true to all human beings. One of them is connections with other humans, right? To the degree that we can slow it down and feel safe enough to connect, connection with another human really helps that activation to deactivate and to settle. You know, and maybe some people are aware of the terms we use in trauma of social engagement, right? It's our nature as humans, again, to engage with other people. So really slowing things down, seeing how much availability there is to engage. Sometimes when someone's really triggered, there's not much availability. So it's more about giving them enough time and space for that activation to come down, because it takes about 3 times as long for it to come down as it does to come up. That's how our nervous system is designed. So giving them time and space and helping them to find any kind of what we call resource. And again, to some people, it's a common term, to some people it's not. So that's why I'm sort of trying to explain things as we go here. Anything that's a resource that helps the person feel a little less triggered, a little less not safe, in other words, a little more safe, right? A little more connected to themselves, a little more connected to the earth, which is a great resource in general, and a little more connected to someone they trust there. Does that make sense? Does that help at all, Summer?
Yep. And Russ, if you you allow me, I will just add into that wonderful.
Please,
that you have given there. Yes, Summer, thank you very much for the wonderful work that you're doing. Yeah. So as you slow down, I think what we call orientation, it's so important. I've done so many times this orientation thing, but every minute, remember to do it. Like when they can turn their neck really slow, it has to do with social engagement, but I just wanted to reiterate it to kind of make it, to expand it. Like when you turn your neck really slowly and just look around, that very slowly, because when you activated, people tend to just go like that and they even get dizzy. But when they go really slowly looking, they might see like a little ant on the wall, and they smile. They said, oh yeah, I just saw an ant walking over the wall and it made me smile. And that's the way they kind of begin to find the resource. But also, I mean, as they are looking around, they actually come across a lot of things that remind them. I always talk about this resonance thing that we use in a sea, yeah, resonance. Because the healing is always within us and it's always out here. And of course your presence there, but also they can do this on their own. You know, when you are looking around slowly, you always come up something that it's part of your own healing. They might come up a phrase on their own wall that they haven't read it or they even see it every day, but it doesn't touch them that much. But at that moment of activation that's connected to the wall, they will read that phrase and they said, well, yeah, anyway, God, I'm glad I'm here. But like we talk about survival, I'm glad I'm here. I could have died many times in that wall, being part of that wall, but I'm right now here. And then of course that we kind of take advantage and expand that being here and now. Because the being in the present moment, it's one of the best resources that we have. There's nothing else you can do but being here and finding the pleasure of being here right now, small pleasures of being here right now, and becoming aware that you are no longer in the war. Other people right now are, but right now you are just recovering from it. You know, that is so, so important, that constant reminder. So I hope that helps together with what Jonas just finished saying. Thank you, Ami.
Thank you.
Yeah. Awesome.
Just so you know, I'm known as Jonas in Latin America. That's my name from Mexico to Argentina. And so F was used to calling me Jonas. I get to have two personalities. Isn't that fun?
It is. Yes.
And thank
when
you so
I think
much,
of you.
Thank Go you. Ahead. Thank you so much, Afu. And thank you for adding on and bringing up that piece of the orientation, which is so important because, you know, war and the threat of war is so disorienting for all of us. So that process of reorienting is so essential for all of us, for all of our health.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. What you had to share about this, the absolute slowness. And I just found myself really enjoying the neck movements of doing that slow. So if anybody's with us, you know, and you hear Efua Russell say something like, I hope you're doing it at home right now, because this topic can be activating, right? And many of you who are in Europe may be experiencing some things firsthand. You may be working with refugees. I wanted to ask you, Russell and Effie, if you could speak a little bit to this question. Someone else had posed it to me outside of the chat. It was an SCP. She was very advanced in her work with somatic experiencing, which, folks, if you don't know what that is, we'll tell you a little bit more later. And as a thank you for attending, we'll give you access to some learning opportunities on us. But this person was a very advanced somatic experiencing practitioner, therapist of many years, and was doing some crisis response with people who were in crisis. And it was right at the start of the Ukraine-Russia conflict. And we did one little exercise, and in the midst of the exercise, she just burst into tears. And she said, "My goodness, I had no idea I was so affected." And then what happened in waves is she said, "I'm a survivor of war in South America. And I guess I just immediately leapt into this place of, oh, we've got to be dealing with the refugees. We've got to be supporting our colleagues in Poland and in Europe." And then she just became really present to herself. And so my question and her question around that is like, how do you, like, you know, there's certain topics, if you raise them, I know I'm going to be triggered by them. I know we maybe don't use that word as much anymore, but there's certain topics that I know will hit me. But what do you do if you, how can you check yourself to know if you are really impacted? Like, how can someone become more self-aware that they might be having a reaction to an event? You know, like, I'm not sure that question's even coming out. I guess I'm just asking you to comment, riff, chat about it with us. Because she was so wise and so self-aware and was surprised like several weeks in to realize she was as upset as she was. So how do we become more self-aware and grounded and expansive in our resilience for holding past stress in the current light of current circumstances?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Efu.
Yeah. Okay. I guess you felt that energy. Like I'm like, yeah. That's so nice how we are connected, right? Jonas, thank you. Yeah, well, I was actually immediately just thinking, how do we know that? You know, we have talked about activation. Yeah. Whenever we remember, whenever we are brought into the memories of trauma, any kind of trauma, it could even be developmental trauma, it could be any kind of trauma we experienced before that can have its own understanding as well. It connects that its impact could actually remind them of the war. So the important thing is not to actually know the history of what happened out there, but it is to know what is happening inside the body. Like Peter Levine, our founder, talked about that the trauma itself, it is not in the event, but in the body, in our nervous system. So what we actually, how we know, first of all, we notice our body, we can feel our breath going to really rapid, really quick. We can feel our heartbeat racing. We can feel our muscles actually tightening up. We can feel everything gets tense in our body, and we find we will know it from our own body. Now, being present in our own physiology, once you said, oh my gosh, what's going on in my body? Once you say that and you begin to notice, maybe we just kind of pay attention to one, maybe into your heartbeat and just hold it and say, wow, my heartbeat, my heart is racing. And you can say, well, what happened? Oh, I don't know, maybe it's the war that happened there. We kind of make sure that we uncouple, we separate from bringing in more memories of the traumas that happened and just focus on the body and kind of, not, as we are focusing in the body in that moment of the heartbeat and all that, we can feel that the heartbeats are going down slowly. And once they are going down, then we can capture that. Wow, it's getting better. Isn't that wonderful? So, and then we stay with that, and then we can bring other resources. Like if this person, for example, talking that was reminded of the war in South America, we might want to ask a question like, wow, what helped you survive? Yeah, again, you read that survival thing. you are alive, you are here. What helped you survive? And once they mentioned that, I said, well, I don't know. It was some kind of spirit or my ancestors that helped me. But then we capture that and we actually help to expand it so that they can calm their nervous system down. Really, we have so many categories of trauma, but we bring it down into our nervous system. The reactions from our nervous system, it's almost the same because it's the activation of whatever is happening in our body. So that's where we kind of keep reminding people, being in the present moment in the body with some resources that helps. And then once in a while, maybe going outside, looking at what is outside the body, and then go back to the body. And as soon as the body, like Russell talked about, of course, as soon as we are able to deactivate, we are able to bring the nervous system reset itself, then actually the new meanings comes up, like, wow, I'm so glad right now I'm not in the middle of it. You know, I'm so glad I'm here. And maybe I can pray for them, or I can send energy, or I can do whatever I can. Yeah. So that's what I will say for now. And I will throw the ball. I have the image. He has the real one. I have the imaginary one. Okay, Jonas, there you go.
Thank you so much, Efu. So Efu, if it's okay, Ami, maybe this is a time to call everybody who wants to come on screen and we do a little bit of an exercise, yeah?
I love
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Let's do it.
Yeah,
let's
fantastic. Do it. Good. We all can get better together. Camera. You guys, this is the weird part and the fun part, but seriously, no kidding. It's all different times around the planet. Oh, Russell, what was that high-tech feature you just did? Oh my God.
It's called a Zoom. Zoom.
Zoom. Wow, you just zoomed on Zoom. People, would you please raise your hand if you are in the chat, in the panelist side. If you are a guest with us today, would you please raise your hand if you would be up for us bringing you on screen to do an exercise with Russell and Efu? Please, please, please come join us.
And you can still do the exercise if you're not on screen, right, Ami?
No, you're not allowed. You have to come on screen. This is high pressure. No, being nice, Russell. Come on. All right. We're going to bring Michelle.
That's a tough
rule. Michelle's ready to come over. We're going to bring a few over.
Yeah. So that Efu and I don't have to just look at ourselves here.
Yeah. Go ahead and turn
exactly.
on.
Exactly.
Turn on your, when you come on exactly. over, go ahead and start your video so we can see you. Hey, yeah. Michelle.
Hi, Michelle.
Who else would be up for joining us?
Ami is doing strong encouragement there.
This is called strong encouragement.
that's why he's called. Oh, Rabia is with us. Okay.
Awesome. Yes, hi, Rabia.
Tanya.
And here comes Tanya. All right. So you all can keep raising your hand. We'd love to have you. The more, the merrier. I know sometimes it's.
So let's go ahead and start. Everybody, I invite you to stand up. You know, if you're comfortable, if you're not comfortable standing up, you can sit down, but I invite you to stand up. And, you know, Ami was asking about self-awareness and Efu was talking about feeling our body, right? The language of our body is sensation. So when you stand up, what do you notice? What sensations do you notice in your body? You know, I really notice my feet when I'm standing, and I notice my feet kind of looking to grab on to finding the best place. What do you notice? Whether you're on camera, hi Karina, you got somebody with you. That's great. So what do each one of you notice when you bring your attention to your body here at this moment?
I come off, you guys can come off mute. I know sometimes when we do exercises in SECC, we all sit. Come off mute, go ahead and share, get related. This is an important time to get connected.
Yeah. So if you want to open your microphone and say what you're feeling, go for that too.
Wow.
Anybody want to share what you're feeling as you connect into your experience at this moment?
Yeah, I'll share. I've been sitting for a long time, so it feels really good to finally stretch out my spine and my neck.
Yeah. Yeah. See, this is great for Zoom land that we've been living in for the last 2 years. Thank goodness for Zoom land, but this is great to stand up and feel our body. And Effa was talking about organizing out the space because everybody's in a different space.
Yeah.
So checking out your space. Just noticing how it feels. Does it feel safe at this moment? Does it feel comfortable? Does it feel warm? Does it feel cool? Does it feel heavy? Does it feel light? How does it feel to be in your space at this moment? There's a bunch of wind here. You might even be able to hear it. The trees are, I'm in the rainforest. The trees are hitting up against the building. So if I go offline, Effu, because of the wind, you're going to jump in, right?
Yes, I will. No problem.
Okay.
But you will be here.
So for me, as I check out my space, a deep breath comes. What happens for anybody, for you? Anybody want to share what happens as you kind of check out the space you're in right now at this moment? What happens in your body?
Just a sharp contrast between the light coming from the window and the kind of darkness of the rest of the room, and how those differences in light made me feel. That was really interesting.
Neat. That's cool. Thanks, Michelle.
How'd they make you feel, Michelle? Mm-hmm.
Like, I was drawn to the light and I wanted to just look out the window and not continue looking at the rest of the dark room. And I was very interested in the effect that the light had on me.
Yeah. Wow, Russell, I'm just going to jump in. Michelle, that's so cool. Like, just standing up a few different, completely changed your perspective on reality where you were, is what I did. Like, that's what was just moving me as you were saying that, why I had to ask you. I got so curious. I'm noticing, Russell, as you had us all stand, like very few of us are standing static. As soon as you had to stand, there was a lot of movement. It was like everybody started swaying. There was something about standing that like gave me access to everything. Like,
And that's part of what we're talking about when that activation comes up, right? In that case that you brought up, Ami, of the SCP, that person, some trigger comes up. We never know what's going to trigger that activation, right? It's often spontaneous. That's the nature of our nervous system. So when that activation comes up, one of the first things we can do is really open up our space here. Stand up, allow the movement. Movement really helps the activation to deactivate and to go down there, right? And it's also helpful, just notice where the exits are from your room, right? That's also a helpful tip towards safety. Where's the door, right? Where's the door? Where's the window? And notice that you have a clear path to that. Hopefully you have a clear path. If not, you can move, right? If you don't have a clear path to the exit, you can move. Yeah, so laughter, humor is a great resource, right? It's a great resource for discharging, lowering activation. You want to say something, Effu? Go for it.
Yeah, sure. I wanted to say that, you know, even for us being here, we have to name it. Of course, I mean, you see, we are very spontaneous and all that, but of course you're concerned I'm speaking right, maybe, and you know, everything is going on well. So I didn't realize how much tense I was on my shoulders. But once Russ told us to stand up, I stood up and all of a sudden, oh my gosh, my shoulders were so tense. So it was very nice. And these movements kind of helped me to kind of let go of that tension. It's like, oh, cool, look, now I see everybody there. It's so nice, the social engagement too, when we see everybody out there. Then everything became more natural and my body started moving very, very natural and slightly. So this helps us even in this activity that I was tense. You know what I mean? That's how spontaneous that the threat comes in very small ways. Thank you.
Yeah. spontaneous. That's the thing. Those triggers are spontaneous and the responses are spontaneous. That's really one of the big keys to working with trauma and to being alive, is inviting, recognizing, and following the spontaneous. So what's a spontaneous movement? What do you feel like doing? You want to raise your hands? You want to make a bigger space? You want to dance? What do you feel like doing? Whatever comes up, let it come up spontaneous. Go for it, Rabia. Whatever you feel like doing, stretching feels good. Moving, looking around. Oh, we often finish the day with some good dance music too, right? Inviting some spontaneous movement. So I'm going to invite you to do just one more thing, and then we can go back to our seats or whatever, which is look at your screens and just notice who on the screen draws your attention there. Which little box pulls your attention right now that gives you, there's some attraction, some desire to connect with that person, maybe curiosity about them, maybe curiosity about their space. You know, which one? It might be more than one, but who's drawing your attention right now at this moment? And just notice what that feels like in our body when we allow ourselves to be drawn to connect with another person.
Like, I have to say this. So Anna and I, we're originally from Russia. We went to school together 20 years ago, and we reconnected recently. And obviously, the war in Ukraine has added a sort of a dimension to it. So it's really special. I think we haven't actually been in this space together before. So it's really, really lovely and it's quite special to be here. Nice. So thank you, everyone. We've both been outside of Russia for over 20 years. So, and I do have someone in the background. Yes, indeed.
Yes.
That's nice. Wonderful. So you've renewed your connections then, huh?
Yeah.
Wow. How does that feel? How does that feel in your body? If you let me ask, I'm going to
It's really special. You know, it's... sorry, I've got family stuff going, but it's really lovely. It's a lot of softness. Yeah.
Softness. Anybody else want to share what you're feeling in your body as you connect to the other people here on the screen? It can be somebody who's off screen. If you want to put it, write it in the chat, feel free.
I'm really drawn to Daniela's background. It looks like you're outside and like I can see your tree, and that just looks, I've been orienting to your background for a little while. It's very calming. Yeah. I'm happy right now, so it's a little chaotic, but I'm loving being able to see that.
There's a lot of birds around me. That's really grounding to me and calming.
Yeah. You can even hear them, Danielle.
Yeah, we can hear the birds chirping.
Summer.
Yeah.
Well, thank you everyone for coming on for this exercise. That's really, it's Russell. It was just, and Effie, it was so powerful. Like, it was so simple that you just let us do this. Yeah. But I just we'll send you guys back to the attendance side as we're coming together. Thank you for your participation in a big, special, huge way. And Karina and Anna, I cannot not name how touching it was. Effie, Russell, wasn't that particularly trust? Like 20 years. And so it was like just even being witness to that connection was really powerful.
Yes.
I noticed I felt more connected because they were connected. And so I'm just going to take this moment to just name, like, we just spent like 10 minutes in this exercise, right? And for people who have studied somatic experiencing deeply, Like, we know, like, that wasn't just a get on screen high and stand there. Like, we actually just did about 50 exercises in 10 minutes. I'm just gonna like unpack it a little bit from the lens of a program we currently have in development called Crisis Stabilization and Safety, where like something I'm taking from that exercise, Russell, is just how sitting down and standing up was a tiny little thing that just changed everything in my visual worldview and my sensing worldview. And if we're looking at like what are bite-sized protocols we can do to just get access to a little bit of wellness or to just alter the current frame that we're in, it's as simple as going from sitting to standing can give you something, a new perspective. Yeah. In the Crisis Stabilization and Safety program that's gonna be coming out later this year, we'll be teaching people SE-informed crisis intervention and peer support models, where we go from the huge world of trauma resolution down to a little bit more compact and bite-sized kind of little protocols, taking apart little exercises and saying, what if I just did that? What if I just did that one tiny little piece of that and got something better? Yeah. So I just want to name how powerful it was to be with the whole somatics of that in the room. And to tell you all, if you want to learn more about crisis stabilization and safety, Rabia will be putting a link in the chat where you can express your interest about learning about the program so we can keep you up to date on it. Or if you'd like to become a facilitator of the program, we can share with you another link about that. And okay, so I don't have to interrupt 10 times with announcements. I'll make just a couple more right now rather than doing 5 more times so people can get more on a roll. If you are not currently a somatic experiencing practitioner and you don't know what we're talking about, that is a trauma resolution modality founded by Dr. Peter Levine. Efu and Russell are some of our favorite, okay, just personally speaking, some of my favorite faculty in our program. We have a global faculty and we've trained more than 125,000 people around the planet on this method. You can learn more about it at traumahealing.org. And as a thank you for attending today, if you email us at publichealth@traumahealing.org, Rabia will send you a link to what we call SE Basics. It's a 3-hour online live program about what SE is, and you can understand a little bit more of the fundamentals. And you may want to go on to take the program and just email us and we'll see what we can do to support you, especially if you're somewhere on the planet responding to the crises that you're facing right now in your own domain. We really want to make sure that we are fulfilling our charitable obligation to make sure the world has access to the resources we know are so deeply useful and important and critical to resolve trauma after it's there, but also interrupt it and support it or increase the resilience prior to facing events like this. Okay, so do I need to say anything else? If you want to donate to us, www.traumahealing.org/donate. Okay, that was my commercial break for that. I don't think I have any more commercial break things to say. I just wanted to get that out of the way. Thanks for letting me do that, guys.
Okay.
I'm just going to go into the background again. And we do have a question in the chat. I keep saying chat and Q&A interdependently. But there was a really interesting question presented by someone who was with us. And I'm gonna just drop off and y'all just talk amongst yourselves. Don't worry about teaching, just talk amongst yourselves. You do whatever you do. Sorry, I don't mean to tell you. question. Yeah, you know what? I've been me my whole life, so I know how this one shows up. So the question was something about how do you experience, how can you possibly speak about the experience of being on the side of the aggressor? Like maybe not being the aggressor, but being on the side of like the complicatedness. And this may go into some ancestral trauma and things. You know, I just saw Bury My Heart Wounded Knee last night. And I was very, very much aware of myself on the aggressor side of history as I was watching that and how all the layers of terror and horror within me knowing that. So I think this is what this question is getting to. It says, could you possibly speak about the experience of those on the side of aggressor, which is Russia in the particular case with the Ukraine, many layers of history. There's a lot of shame, shock, and confusion, and also growing defensiveness and hatred for the other, sadly, on both sides. So just speaking to that complexity of that I'll just step up. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, Russ. So I will kick us off on that one. Yeah. You know, I could feel my body and my mood changed. It's amazing. Just you talking about that, Ami, like being on the side of the aggressor. What happened to me? Of course, because we are connected in a deeper level in our aggressions too. So when you say that, I felt it in my body, like a deep, deep kind of a fight energy coming out of also for me, either to run away or to also hit back. Yeah, that's how my body felt right away as you brought out the word aggressor. Having said that, I'm becoming aware of my breath. And that's how I actually work with it. Yeah. First of all, I noticed that I'm becoming also the same way because we are connected by the energy field. We are connected by the resonance. So if there's an aggression here, probably it is inside of my own nervous system also, or my energy field. So what is really needed right away? It's an awareness. So as I am talking, as I was talking to begin to answer this question, I took a deep breath and that helped me to uncouple, to separate that engagement with aggression and just feeling my body. I continue to really feeling the energy going down to the earth, to the ground. So what I'm doing, I'm actually letting go of my aggression. And as I'm letting go of my aggression, that actually helped the other person also, the aggressor that we are calling out there. That helped them to also kind of follow into that resonance. Yeah. So the best way to actually be able to be there is to be in touch with our body, with our own aggression, and to let go of it slowly, using our own resources also. Maybe if it's too much, I might want to move a little bit. Make a move, yeah. We talk about movement as we were doing this exercise with Jonas. I noticed that what is really helpful, it is the movement. So probably I might want to make a step a little bit far, you know, like I'm not facing by trying to fight, but I'm facing to move away a little bit so I can get my own bearings, what is better for my own survival. Yeah, because the most important it is our own survival. So paying attention to my own processes, my own body, my own breath, my own activation, it's really helpful when we are with the aggressor. And one little thing before I pass the ball to, I'm letting his nervous system know that before I pass the ball to you, just in a minute, Russell, I just wanted to say one more thing that, you know, we are connected in a very deeper level because that we are not aware of. Just talking, when I read a little bit about the war, I hear a little bit about the war. I know those two countries, they are almost like one. They're connected in so deep a way. The ancestors of these people, they're all the same blood, the same DNA. So it's almost like when we go back, I work quite a bit with transgenerational trauma, and we find that where we have fight, these are things from the past that are not dealt with. We are fighting out here, but if we go down deep, we might connect in a deeper level and found that we are the same, if we are, you know, and we can find peace if one person is a little aware in paying attention and not always responding with the same kind of tone of the aggression. And I'm not preaching religion. I'm just saying that the body and awareness that really help us to liberate ourselves from that situation. So Russ, I promise I'm passing the ball to you right now.
Thank you. Thank you, Afu. I was getting up and down because of my therapy black cat, Mr. Bean, was coming in and tearing up the carpet to because he wanted to be part of what was happening. Maybe you heard him doing that. We were instructed by Ami back there not to turn our microphone off. So I was letting him play and tear up things. So he just went back out. It's okay, Ami. Thought you might want to know that, but it's fine. We SE teachers can follow the rules sometimes, you know. So cute little heart. So that's a little levity throwing in there. You know, the whole interesting part, you know, thank you so much, Efu, about, you know, bringing up how that affects each one of us individually and how we all have aggression inside of us, right? We all understand aggression on some level and how that's been part of our nature to feel that. And this area of war is an area that connects, as we sort of talked about a little bit before, really to the meaning aspect of our world. You know, what is the meaning of our interrelationships? What is the meaning of me? You know, what is my reason for being here and helping out or being alive? And you know, and that question, that meaning there, we take on different roles, you know, and sometimes it's a government that takes on the role. Sometimes it's a community. Sometimes it's some specific group, you know, and one role is the role of the aggressor and another role is a role of the victim, right? And another role may be the role of the savior. You know, that's like the Karpman triangle, but you can look at that a lot of different ways, that those places of being in that place, all of us as human beings, every human being at some point in your life has been an aggressor. Every human being at some point in their life has been a victim. Every human being at some point in their life has been a helper or a savior. In other words, the one who tries to help the other people who are stuck in those places. We all, it's our human nature. We all recognize those different positions and those different roles. And the challenge is to find that part, or a challenge to find that part in each of us, so that we don't just destroy each other, right? And that's, you know, I had the good fortune to visit Peace Park in Japan. Since I'm teaching SE and Aikido in Japan, it's ground zero where the Hiroshima bomb was dropped. They preserved it. And there's a museum there with all sorts of things from the original bomb, what happened there. And also there's a meditation room underground with 120,000 tiles there, one for each person who died in the Hiroshima bomb. So one thing that comes up for me, and it comes up for a lot of people, is in any war in the world today now is the threat of nuclear war, which would mean, could mean annihilation for us as a human species, right? And so that has a lot to do with that, tying into that aggressor part. You know, it's been talked about recently a lot. Even Henry Kissinger has been saying that possibility is out there of strategic nuclear weapons being used in specifically in the Ukraine conflict, but in any conflict. So that comes to that, speaks to that in the bigger picture. Efa was taking it from the individual picture. I've taken it all the way to the global picture there. If we don't recognize the aggressor in us, we will destroy each other, right? You know, so we all have that capacity to be aggressor, to be victim, to be savior. And the more we can recognize that and recognize that in the other and ourselves, and maybe step out of those roles to see the humanity there, that can be very healing. There's many, many groups that have brought perpetrators, aggressors, and victims together to heal. And many of them have had really interesting results. Doesn't always work, but it often does for people to see that we all have both sides there. So we've all been on the side of the aggressor. We've all been on the side of the victim. We've all been on the side of the caretaker, the savior. It's universal. Those are universal, even archetypical roles, to use Jungian ideology there, that we can all recognize. And when we recognize it in ourselves, it can be very heavy, but it can also be very healing, very powerful there too. You know, and as Effa was saying, it's in our DNA, right? All the conflicts that have come before us, somehow that's in our DNA. That's part of who we are there.
Yeah. Yeah. And we are connected in a deeper level. Like many times we say, we are one, eh? We are one. You know, we are all one with the nature and with everything else. And it's so easy to say it, and probably we don't take it so deep as we talk about it, really. Yeah, I mean, when I work with the transgenerational trauma, I notice that oftentimes when people begin to heal, they realize that those whom they were having conflict with, they're people who are very close to them, or they're part of their life. And then, of course, that's when the reconciliation happened, because we realize that we are fighting against ourselves. You know, we are actually killing ourselves. So, I mean, I wish the whole universe will be able to actually get some information like this, where they can just pay attention to their own body. I always say that we have a number of systems, right? So we have our nervous system, and then we have a family system, and then we keep going up, and then we come to this bigger community and groups and different ones. And then we have the governments, you know, the society system. But all of them, though, comes down to our nervous system. Yeah, that's where we are affected. Yeah, we don't realize we can have a lot of political, you know, what's better, and all of this will come up into the higher level. But the effect eventually comes to our nervous system. Well, of course, we have all these, we get sick, we get toxins, we get everything, it comes into our body. So, and like Russell is saying, how do we actually become aware of all these connections that we have from our energy level, which is connected to our ancestors, and it goes on connecting in so many different levels of our community and society, where we really discover that we're just in this one planet, Earth, that is round, and it's all one, we're all one people. But it is very hard to kind of understand that by our cortical brain. But if we bring it down into our energetic level, that's where we can begin. And I go back to that place we said at the beginning of take a breath. When you are really in touch with your breath and your life, then that's where we begin to help each other to connect through that breath, the air that we all breathe together, and that connect us as a people. Yeah. So those of us who can begin to do it, maybe it's nice, we can begin to do it, and then we create a resonance that will come to those who are not ready to do it. That's what we can do. So we cannot call everybody to do it at the same time because of all our different levels of traumas. Yeah, and those of us who are lucky to have a bigger container, in SE we call container, like we have more resilience, then we can actually hold those who are not there yet. So I begin with my own nervous system calming down, and then the person next to me will also calm down. And then it goes on like that, and it comes down to the whole universe. I think we can actually do something like that. Thank you. Russ, I give it back to you.
Thank you, Effu. Yeah, I mean, that's one. Sometimes we sort of jokingly say that when we're working with SE, we're trying to change the world one nervous system at a time, right? Which means one person at a time. And we each have our own individual nervous system. And as Effa has mentioned, that term resonance so many times, which is so beautiful. When we're with other human beings, it's our mammalian nature to resonate with them, which means we can resonate into more activation, or we can resonate into calmness too there. And all you need is two people to resonate, but then you can get into bigger groups, families, as she said, and communities and whole societies, and then the whole human population of the 7.5 billion people there are on the earth now. You know, so there is a resonance by nature there. And we start with ourselves. Yeah. So I think, Ami, we're coming to the end of our time. Is there a way that you would like to finish this?
Yeah, so sometimes if we have a lot of questions popping up in the Q&A, we go for a little bit longer, but I think that people are pretty just mesmerized in what you've been sharing naturally, and there aren't a whole lot more questions. So folks, I'm gonna put out there that if you do have another question that's unanswered, I did prime these lovelies to see if we could go a little longer if there were more. But if there's not another question, then I think, so here's what I'm noticing right now, and I'll kind of ask you to wrap up kind of in, maybe with response to this. What I'm noticing is that, you know, we have this topic that's really intense and heavy, right? And I'm sitting here with a big smile on my face and I'm laughing with you guys and I'm enjoying you. Uh-huh. And it feels like for a lot of people, like when there's pain or distress happening in the environment, that like maybe I'm not supposed to be joyful, right? I know in some cultures, you know, funerals may be celebrations, and in other places they might say never. I guess I'm speaking, can you speak a little bit to that tension of just making some space to not have to hold the heaviness or the anguish or the burden? Like, is this okay? Is it okay to find resource with each other and health and joy amidst unpleasant, dire, or even horrific circumstances? Would you speak a little bit to that, and then I'll come on and we'll close up.
Russ, if you don't mind, I'll go again. I don't know, I'm very spontaneous. Like if the question come up and I feel like, oh wow, that's, I have some ideas coming up, I just jumped in. Yeah. Okay. So I think with that question, it is so important to live every moment fully. Yeah. For example, if we have somebody died, or there's something that is horrific that happens, and we feel it in our body, to allow ourselves to mourn at that very moment that it happens, it's very, very important. Yeah. So we take time to mourn, to cry, to feel that sadness deep in our heart, in our muscles, in our cells. It's very important to do that. And we do that together with whoever needs to do that. Yeah. So then we actually transition from that to another moment now of letting go of that moment of sadness. And then we can live every moment. We live now this moment of our time here. So, I think right now we are actually sharing resources for people who are, have been going through this crisis, threat of war and any other crisis that are going on. Yeah, so we are talking about it, but we are not in the crisis right now, this moment of the screen. So we are bringing on some resources so that people can benefit from. That's why we can actually laugh, because the laugh, yeah, and into some movement and whatever we shared out here, it is very important. So we are living this intensely, this moment of being able to bring out the resources for all of you out there, for the whole world, for the entire universe. It is very important. Now, if we happen to be in a camp where we are helping people who had just have a bomb dropped on them, of course we won't be laughing, we won't be smiling. We are actually trying to be there present with them. And then maybe in the middle of it, we might find a moment of a smile also. So, but that the key thing here is to learn how to live every minute, every second intensely, yeah, in the present moment. And then we transition to that, noticing what is happening around. Yeah, so okay. Russ, I will let you offer my comment on this.
Well, that was so beautiful, Efu. I don't know that I need to comment much more. I would just say that, you know, living each moment and finding the joy in each moment. And then also, you know, life is, we have two poles for almost everything. You know, in order to experience pleasure, we experience pain. In order to experience great joy, we need to experience great sadness. It's part of being human, right? It's that great range of life and emotion that we have, that we can experience that great sadness, that great loss, that great heaviness, so that then we can also experience the joy there, the two sides of that. And sometimes it takes a long time to go through the sadness there to get to the joy, and then we can have even more ample, more greater joy there. It's that huge range of sensation and emotion that, as you mentioned, Efu, is our nature as resilient beings, right? We're incredibly resilient. Human beings can survive incredible, horrific, terrible long-term events and situations and come through that to later again experience joy, to come back to joy and to appreciate life all the more. On that, there's just so many examples of that. I won't go into it now, but there's so many examples out there of that, and that appreciation that we get for life by going through those challenging moments.
Yes.
Well, this was one of the least challenging hour and a half I've had in the week. So thank you. Thank you so much, both of you. I want to just really thank you from Efu. It's the middle of the night where she is in Korea, and you are radiant and full of the joy of the moon right now. And Russell is deep in the rainforest with the wind and the wolves howling. And you've both taken your time to just be a gift to the planet, to share your perspective on this topic and to relate. And I just want to thank you and honor you for your choice so much. And also thank you to everyone in SEI, from the staff and all of the faculty and all the way through to the community. Many of you are you've taken our programs, and if you haven't, I consider that as of today, you're welcome to consider yourself part of the community. A resource I think we all have is the experience of belonging to each other on the planet. And my wish is, in closing, one way that we deal with the threat of war is may we have the experience of belonging, of being included and involved. I really salute each one of you who's attended today or who's even watching this on YouTube out of time and space. You're still involved. You're welcome. You're included. And just thank you all. We will see you next month. We have another exciting topic for you in the field of public health on the second Friday of every month at noon Mountain Time, where we will keep an eye on our Facebook page and on our newsletters. You can email us if you're not on the newsletter and you would like to be for any other events. And we will be hosting this one again then. As for today, is there anything you'd like to say? Do we just call this a wrap, folks? Is this just beautiful? Can we call on every blessing in the universe for health and healing? And may I not leave out peace? May we actually get access to peace, healing, and resolution on every level of our humanity. Mm.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ami. Thank you, Russ. Thank you, Ami. Thank you, Russ. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, everybody, yes, for hanging out with us and watching, too, whoever was out there still.
Yes, thank you.
See you next time.
Okay. See you next time.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.